नमस्ते ऑल ऑफ यू, दिस इज जीवन राहुल शर्मा। आई एम असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर ऑफ माइक्रोबायोलॉजी इन द एपीडी डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ज्योति विद्यापीठ विमेंस यूनिवर्सिटी जयपुर राजस्थान। टुडे आई एम डिस्पेंसिंग दिस वीडियो फॉर बीएमएलटी सेकेंडरी सेमेस्टर स्टूडेंट्स। आई हैव कवर्ड ऑलमोस्ट 90% ऑफ योर सिलेबस। टुडे आई एम स्टार्टिंग द ब्लड बैंक टॉपिक्स। वॉट आर द प्रिंसिपल, वॉट आर द स्टोरेज मेथड्स एंड वॉट इज द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ ब्लड बैंक and what are the method of sampling, what are the collaborative procedure. Okay, so basically blood bank is a center where blood gathered as a result of blood donation. It is stored and preserved for later use in blood transfusion, and the term blood bank typically refers to a division of a hospital where the storage of blood product occurs and where proper testing is performed to reduce the risk of transfusion related adverse events. However, it sometimes referred to a collection center and some hospitals and also perform collection. So blood banking includes tasks related to blood collection, processing, testing, separation and storage. So there are five step: collection, processing, testing, separation and storage. Okay, so types of blood transfusion or types of blood transfused. So first is, there are several types of blood transfusion exist, like whole blood, platelet transfusion and plasmapheresis or plasma transfusion. So blood test in which blood test means whole blood. Whole blood means there are all types of cell present there, and all types of proteins and all types of organic and inorganics in plasma. So whole blood means plasma and cells. So this is blood transfusion without separation. It is an intact blood withdraw from the donor. So red cell or packed cell is transfused to patient with anemia or iron deficiency. It also helps to improve the oxygen saturation in blood. It can be stored at 1 to 6 degrees centigrade for 35 to 40 days with the additives or anticoagulants. Okay, like CPDA, CPDA1, CPDA2. Okay, so these additives increase the lifespan of the cells. In platelet transfusion, is transfused to those who suffer from low platelet count, and platelet can be stored at room temperature for up to 5 to 7 days. So single donor platelet which have more platelet count, but it is bit expensive than the regular. So plasma transfusion is indicated to patients with liver failure, severe infection of serious burns. Fresh frozen plasma can be stored at very low temperature of minus 25 to up to 12 months. And the separation of plasma from donor blood is called plasmapheresis. So I want to share the some history of blood bank and how blood bank invented. Okay, so while the first blood transfusion were made directly from donor to receiver before coagulation, it was discovered that adding anticoagulants and refrigerating the blood, it was possible to store it for some days only. But nowadays we can store the blood for 45 days with the help of anticoagulants, with the help of the advanced techniques, with the help of advanced additives. So thus opening the way for development of blood banks. John Braxton Hick was the first to experiment with the chemical method to prevent coagulation of blood at St. Mary Hospital, London, in late 19th century. In 19th century, his attempts using phosphate of soda and however were unsuccessful. The first non-direct transfusion was performed on March 27, 1914 by the Belgian Dr. Albert Hastin. Though this was a diluted solution of blood, and Argentine Dr. Luis Ajot used much less diluted solution in November of the same year. Both used sodium citrate as an anticoagulant. First World War. The First World War acted as the catalyst for the rapid development of blood banks and transfusion technique. So Canadian Lieutenant Lawrence Bruce Robertson was instrumental in the persuading the Royal Army medical camps or medical corporation to adopt the use of blood transfusion at the casualty clearing stations for the wounded. In October 1915, Robertson performed his first wartime transfusion with syringe to a patient suffering from multiple shrapnel wounds. He followed this up to four subsequent transfusions in the following month, and his success was reported to Sir Walter Morley Fletcher, director of the Medical Research Committee. What are the medical advances? A blood collection program was initiated in US in 1940, and Edwin Cohen pioneered the process of blood fractionation. He worked out the technique for isolating the serum albumin fraction of blood plasma, which is essential for maintaining the osmotic pressure in the blood vessels and preventing their collapse. So, use of blood plasma as a substitute of for whole blood for transfusion purposes was proposed as early as 1918. So, in next video, I will discuss about the processing and collection of the blood. Okay. And what are the principle of blood collection and what are the principle of blood banking. So basically the principle of blood banking is to save the people from harmful diseases, disorders in which they require the whole blood, plasma, platelet. So the basic principle or basic concept of blood banks is to save the people, to save the folks from dying, and this has been successful. And people are saving their lives, doctors are saving their lives by using the blood banks, by donating the blood, by transfusing the blood. And there are more than lakhs blood bank are opened in India these days or throughout the world. So this is the very safe step was discovered by the doctors in 19th century. That we are able to save the people's life, but before that we were unable. And nowadays we have the advanced techniques, advanced machines in blood banks. We can detect the disease in a minute, within seconds, and we are saving the people. So thank you so much for watching this video. Please do care yourself and your family members. This is pandemic time. Everyone is confronting the coronavirus. Everyone is under the jism of coronavirus. So be safe, and in next video I will discuss about the collection, processing and principle of the blood bank. Thank you so much for watching this video. Be safe at home. Namaste, this is JPN Rahul Sharma. I am assistant professor of microbiology in the IPT department of Jyoti Vidyapeeth Women's University, Jaipur, Rajasthan. So today's topic is, what is the role of FNAC in acute and chronic microbial diseases or fungal diseases? So today I am discussing and I am making this video on the role of fungal infection and what is the role of FNAC in fungal infection, and which type of fungal infection can be detected by this technique. Okay, so blastomycosis is a type of disease. It's an epidemiological and clinical situation when blastomycosis should be considered in the differential diagnosis. So blastomycosis was first described by the Gilchrist at the end of the 19th century as a dermatologic infection caused by the protozoan. So today it is known and we know it is caused by the dimorphic fungus blastomycosis dermatitis, and the majority case involves primary lung disease. So the organism has been isolated from moist soil rich in organic debris in Mississippi and Ohio River Valley and around the Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence River. So inhalation of the B. dermatitis conidia is the usual route of infection, and a variety of responses can occur in the lungs, including asymptomatic infection, acute and chronic pneumonia, fatal acute respiratory distress syndrome that is called ARDS, and it's mostly seen in children. A general acute pneumonia is rarely identified outside outbreak. More frequently, pulmonary blastomycosis is diagnosed in case of chronic pneumonia. or when a lung's neoplasia is suspected. In 20 to 40% of cases, the disease has been systematic at the time of diagnosis, and that there is a skin, soft tissue, bone, genitourinary tract, central nervous system involvement. In rare cases, skin lesions without lungs involvement have been described. So suggested direct cutaneous inoculation. Skin lesions most frequently described are painless. These are painless ulcer or varicose lesions. So blastomycosis in immunocompromised patient appear to more severe and more frequently fatal. It should be noted that in patient with CNS involvement, diabetes mellitus is more significant predisposing factors. So what are the morphological characteristics? So B dermatitis in tissue appear as a yeast and measures around 8 to 15 micrometer in diameter, have thick refractile cell wall and may show a single broad based bud. So yeast can be observed in variety of specimen including sputum, bronchoalveolar leverage, fine needle aspiration from the lungs, skin and other lesions, CSF and surgical resections. So basically, the few studies have systematically compared the presence of broad-based budding yeast in histopathologic or cytologic specimen with culture or other diagnostic method like FNDC that would confirm the diagnosis of blastomycosis. So the retrospective study of 53 patients in a study showed that coccoidiosis and hematitis and Candida albicans aspergillus was recovered from 4 pathologic specimen and 10% demonstrating broad-based budding yeast in the direct histopathological examination under the FNAC. So early study of patient with blastomycosis commented that a high percentage of their culture were overgrown with Candida. This suggests that not all broad-based budding yeast in 8 to 15 diameter size range from blastomycosis. Another species cryptococcus. So human cryptococcus is caused by the several cryptococcus species including Cryptococcus neoformans, Cryptococcus gatti. Cryptococcus neoformans is responsible for the majority of infections in immunocompetent and compromised host. So this is another fungus that can be detected by using the FNAC technique, and FNAC technique is nowadays very advanced technique, and every clinician pathologist use this technique to detect the cancer, to detect the thyroid disease, to detect the fungal infection, to detect the bacterial infection. Okay, and the so many type of alternative tests also like radioimmunoassay, ELISA, in serum CSF we perform to detect the fungal infection also. So role of FNAC is very significant for all type of diseases to detect, and these days we are using we are doing this technique for detecting the cancer patient especially, and this is the histopathological technique. We don't involve for FNAC on the all patients. We select the patient first according to the FNAC technique, and which type of patient should be diagnosed under the FNAC condition, and where we should apply this technique and on which patients. So basically we take the sample by using the 20 ml syringe, and that has the 22 gauge needle or 23 gauge needle. Then we put the sample by using the negative force by pulling the piston of syringe, and then we keep that sample on grease free neat and clean slide, and we covered with the help of cover slip. Then we stain it by using so many type of stain I have discussed in previous topic. It was video. And in some condition, we also refer the slides to other diagnostic labs and other clinicians for more confirmation for significant reporting. So this is the FNAC test. We do all to detect all type of carcinomas, thyroid tests, thyroid glands and disease, and in some fungal infections also, and in some bacterial infection. So thank you so much for watching this video. I hope your concept is clear to you. If you have any problem from this topic, from this video, let me know. And if it will be possible, I will clear your all problem with the help of diagram in face-to-face class. Okay. So, namaste. Take care. Be safe at home. And do care yourself and your family members.